Good day, ladies and gentlemen from Washington. This is the Robert Christian Show. It is great to have you all tuned in on today's live show. We have sitting here with us today, the CEO of Gay Life Television in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. We're going to be able to talk to David about what he's doing, about the studio, what got him into it, and we have a fantastic a video that we're going to also be playing and showing everybody a bit of Get Off Television and what's going on there. It's future, who knows? It's past, of course. We sort of kind of know where it's been, but we're going to get down into the subject, I guess, with this, because I want to know from David, and we're going to be talking to him directly about it, as to what actually inspired him early in life to go into broadcasting. I mean, everybody knows that for me, I started back in 1979. And so going from radio to television and now into this format, I mean, it is a completely a different ball game than what it once was. Being a disc jockey at a radio station, been there, done that. But I don't know if David has. I'm sure that he's probably spun a few things around, but I don't know too much about records. We're going to find out, folks, directly. We'll be right back, ladies and gentlemen, right after our intro opener. Here we go.
Number one LGBTQ news talk show. Progressive talk, celebrity interviews, and issues that matter most to you. Join us now.
And thank you, Mr. Maestro. And you know what, folks? Without much further ado, I've got to jump right into this. David, it is great to have you on.
Hi. It's great to be on.
And you know, as a matter of fact, David, I was talking, and I said, you know what? The interesting thing is that this is the first time, David, that you've actually been on this talk show. The first time.
I know.
In what, seven years or something like that?
Yeah, that's kind of rude, actually.
No. Just a little bit.
It took you that long? No.
You know, our schedule at times, when I open it up, we're 6 months out with guests at times, and that has happened more than once, and I'm like, oh, geez. So, David, as we begin today's show with you, let's give everybody a really good before picture as to where you actually, as an individual, where you started in media and what made you want to go into media to begin with, of all things.
That's a question?
Yes.
I thought you were going to say. What happened was, you know, I remember when it happened. Telling you, like, you know, I try not to be like preaching about God and all that stuff, so we'll just call God the universe, or we'll just call the universe God for shorthand. So, you know, I'm like sitting in my house, and I had done like some, remember when podcasting came out?
Yep.
So I'd done some podcasting, and I did a show called Pridecast, and it was pretty good. Like, you know, I was surprised at how well it did. And then I bought a house, and then I was sitting in my attic one day, and I go, Lord, I want you to give me, like, an idea of something. I want to know what my calling is. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I was serious and shit. Like, you know, it was kind of weird. And then all of a sudden, like, this energy came over me, and then the name Gay Life Television came into my head, and then I was told to make it be, like, Lifetime Television, but for gay people. So that's when it actually came into my head, to broadcast at that time.
So you started it in your attic then?
Oh, yes. That's actually where I got the idea, too. Then I ended up starting it there. And then I was there for just a little bit. And then I started working for Out TV, Out Newspaper, which was here in Pittsburgh. And then I started a TV station for them and end up doing some other things. But yeah, I first started in my attic, and then I There used to be this website around called Stick'Em. Did you ever hear that? Stick'Em?
No, I don't think so.
Oh, well, it used to be a really super popular website to broadcast on. Like, you could broadcast 24 hours a day. It was free and all that stuff. So, but the unique thing about it is some of their broadcasters would get millions of viewers. And I was one of the broadcasters that would get millions of viewers. So then I thought, well, I should expand this. So then then Roku was kind of getting popular then too. So then I found out what the qualification process was to be, to have a actual, you know, like they have this thing in Roku called a Roku channel store. And to be in there, you have to qualify, you know. So I wanted to get qualified and then learn how to do all that stuff. So then that took a little bit, that took a little while. And then I got qualified. And then I remember it was on Christmas Eve that I got the thing back from Roku saying I was approved for a channel. Oh, no, I'm sorry. I got approved before that, and then a little bit before that, and then my channel went live on Christmas Eve. So that's when the first time it went live on Roku. And so we've been on there now for like several years. But that's a little bit, you know, how it came to me. But, you know, the why is a little bit different than,
yep.
You know. I was also given the, God also told me why. Yeah, and why is simple. Because, you know, in my view, gay people are underserved in certain areas. And it's interesting because I just did a show with another broadcasting place. And it was about, and I was representing gay television, and it was about gay people not having opportunity within the world of media, like television and this right here and stuff, you know, and to offer solutions for that. So I'm like, well, I am the solution to that, you know. That's my calling. That's what I'm here for on Earth, is for that. I already know that, like, within my body and stuff. So there you go.
Well, I'm there, you know,
gay people.
I know, David, that there is a special. Well, you can find it on the upper tiers of your cable television lineup. And I'm going to leave their name anonymous, but I'm sure you know who they are. But there's one group though that made the mainstream. But the problem is, and we've been sort of paying attention to it for the last several years, but their content, it used to be 100% LGBT related, but anymore it really isn't. They have sort of scaled back, and I really don't like that, David. I think that stations like yours should not be scaling back, but pushing forward.
Well, you know, I do the programming for my station now, you know, because, like, I got people now, but, like, I do the programming mostly. And what I go with is, like, I do not – Gay Life Television, I kept it subscription-based. Now, the stations that you speak of have to rely on advertisers.
Yes.
So these advertisers aren't gay businesses. That's why I tell you, brothers and sisters, you have to support gay businesses. Stop not supporting gay businesses. If you know of a gay store, of a gay business, deliberately go and spend money there. Even if you don't want to, go freaking do it. I'm telling you. The reason why is because you are messing your own world up by not doing that. Okay, you're making like your own opportunities not be there because you got attitude. So stop being that way. I know this. I got 4 or 5 gay businesses. You know what I mean? And it's a shame when I got gay businesses and my some of my better, like, higher customer base is straight people. Are you serious, gay people? Are you serious? Are you? Because that's what I would call ratchet. So stop doing that. Go deliberately go give your money to gay businesses. Okay? Go down to the gay bar, even if you don't want to. Go to the deli. If you know of a gay business, and even if they're not, if you know that they're gay and they own a damn business, go give them your money. It's so important. The reason why is because I try not to be a slave to that. Now, Logo, well, that station is a slave to that.
Okay, David.
You know me. I'm on my own path.
Yeah, he is. Yeah, he is. All right, go ahead. Go ahead.
Wait, and I'm not. And they're a slave to that.
We forgive you, Logo. By the way, we forgive you.
Right now, I'm a slave to the viewer. That's why I have subscription based.
Yeah.
You know, now subscription base is hard. It's like I'm taking the hard, like long road there. You know what I'm saying? To where the other ones aren't. You know, but the long, like doing it the way I'm doing it, I think is better in the long run. Because you know that story about the turtle and the rabbit or something, right? You know, the race thing.
Yep.
So that I believe the slower will win overall. So I try to keep the content LGBT. I have two things. I'll put content that's all LGBT with a mix of other stuff that I like. Because I like nature videos and videos about... I try to teach you things within the broadcast, too. Like, I think I have a video up there on how Ebola, came about.
Yeah.
Followed up by a video of how HIV came about as well. Which you should watch that, people, on Gay Life Television right now. Because HIV is most likely man-made, because it came from a monkey. They have a virus called HIC, something like that, you know. But it's a very good documentary, and it's on Gay Life Television right now.
You know, David, I've got to say, though, that from what I saw, you know, early on, a few years back, I would say several years ago, but it hasn't been that long ago. But I did watch several of the shows that were on Gay Life Television back then, and I was sort of appalled at one or two of them, only one or two of them. But the majority of them, 98% of them, I was like, "All right, good going, David."
Well, sometimes I'll put I want to have the lifetime feeling, of
right.
It. But, you know, I got to have some salt, like pepper in there, too. Like, it's to mix it up some, you know, because sometimes you just want to see a video of guys smoking and kissing or something. You know what I mean? Like, I remember I had this video. It's actually about not smoking, but it's this really risque video, you know, like 20 minutes long. But the theme of it was to actually not smoke. I'll show stuff like that just to mix it up and to show you that, you know, it's true. Like, you know, we force ourselves to live in some sort of false world where we think there just is nothing that's whatever. You know, so right. I think that about television. There's no way to sit there and, you know, who wants to watch television that's goody two-shoes all the time? I need some spice in there. So I sprinkle a little spice in there.
Well, I think that life and anybody, I mean, if you're LGBT or not, everybody can identify with what you just said, David. Because there is far more people in this world that need to add a bit of spice, because otherwise this world can be a very boring and very haunting environment to live in. So why not spice it up a bit?
Well, you know, I made a deal with, like, when God, the universe, you know, told me that information, I was like, listen, I'm not going to do that unless I'm guaranteed that it's not going to work. Like, basically, so like, I want to know that, you know, I'm not going to do it unless I automatically know what I should be doing next, right? So like, and so what I do for my television station is I go with what I feel should be right and good for it, you know. And I really kind of don't care what other people say, because I'm governed by God. Whatever, well, you know what I mean? I got the force of the Lord behind me, so I don't give a fuck.
Well, would you consider Gay Life Television a blasting, blazing success from its inception to present, or would you really wish that Gay Life Television was much bigger, much broader in scope? Maybe what would you change about it?
Well, you know, I try to remain level-headed about it or something, because now the numbers we get nowadays, you know, if I had got these same numbers when I had first started, I would feel so nervous and like shaky inside, because I would know, thousands and thousands of people would be watching me at one time. And like now, I don't even think of that. You know, what was your question, Kyle?
So, would you change anything?
I'm sorry. Yeah. Well, what I would change is I'm always concerned about the numbers. So I try not to be that way. But if I could change anything, well, I guess I would change it to be, we get 11 million viewers a month. Okay. So if I'd gotten that back then, I would have been like, ugh. but now I'm like, that's just not enough. So if I could change anything, I would make that 22 million.
Well, you know, I think that...
And more subscribers.
I think this way, David, that in media, in nursing, if somebody happens to be a doctor or a nurse, if you're in teaching, the bottom line is that you never are going to be satisfied. And that is so great, David, when people aren't satisfied, because they keep pressing forward and they keep looking ahead and saying, you know what, I've got to achieve something even bigger, something even better. I've got to get out there and I've got to do this. But if we ever become so happy and so satisfied with where we are in this life, you might as well give it up.
Yeah.
That's dangerous.
I'm not ever satisfied.
You see what I mean? It becomes very dangerous. I hope I'm not boring you to death, David.
Do I look like I'm bored or something?
No. Hey, let's, David,
It looked like he was hit with a board.
David, he was kind enough to send us a link to a video. David, I want to show everybody this video. Great video. Who did this video before we started?
Well, you know, it was my very first intern. His name is Brian. I'm not going to say his last name because I would mispronounce it, but it's just Brian. And so it was my first intern, and he made this video for me, you know, and I was really impressed. And then I think he also used it for a school project. It's like an assignment that he had.
Mm.
So he used me as his assignment as well. You know, but I could tell you about him more, which, you know, he's a really good example of what should happen to a gay youth. But I'll be glad to tell you about him. I don't know if you want me to do that.
No, well, we can talk about him maybe right after the clip, but as I plan sort of narrate.
You want me to talk over? Yeah, because I'm talking in it. But, well, you know, this video, it was filmed in two locations, really. Like, you'll see a warehouse-looking place, and that's the warehouse that we have. And we do bigger videos there, like bigger production videos. And plus, it's a really cool place to be in. It's like 4,100 square feet, 25-foot high ceilings. Although he didn't really really get a lot of that footage in this video, but you can kind of see a little bit.
All right, let's go over to the video, David, and sort of narrate through it what people are actually seeing and watching. Okay, here we go. Let's see. There we go.
All right, well, that's me sitting there talking. Now, see, that's in the warehouse studio. Now, and that right there would be the office, which is in another building on another street. That's our logo, which, you know, I'm telling you people, when you want a logo like that, that's our lobby. You got to pay a lot of money for logos. That's one of our stars. And this looks like one of our other shoes. But anyway, so what I'm doing there is that's part of one of our broadcasting rooms, actually. And that's where I was sitting. Now, right there, that's another broadcasting studio we have. We call them suites.
Mm.
That's my office there. That's me editing video. But anyway, so Brian is interviewing me about the station, how I got started, and that's me kind of checking out all the broadcasts. And there's me being Mr. Director. Although that's a little bit earlier version. That's when we first got to that building. We have different lights now.
Yeah, I remember that that building. I remember that wall, actually.
Yeah, that was a cute little studio suite. But those particular suites had short ceilings, where the one I'm sitting in right there has, like, the ceilings above me are super tall. He didn't capture them, but you'd be amazed. So we're higher than that right now on our subscribers.
The 228,000?
Yeah, now we have like 319, I think. Or...
Wow, that is incredible. Well, yeah. And then I know that you're talking here. You've got the drag show. What was the name of it, David?
That's another show we produced. That's because we produce several different talk shows. That one's called Drag Talk. This one's called Dirty Talk. Although I think that particular thing was called Council right there. But we have one there called Truth Talk, and that's done with the Gay and Lesbian Community Center here. And, you know, what I try to do is work with the community. And I will go, you know, to a place like a gay and lesbian community center and say, listen, I would like to make a show developed around, you know, what you guys do here. And I want you guys, and I'll even, like, pick a host, you know, out of the people that are there. Mm. You know, find somebody and then, you know, just make it go. Here's the thing, folks. If you want to, like, do something, like, crazy, like, have a TV station, you know, nothing is impossible, nothing at all. There's not one freaking thing in the world that's possible. All right, if I was like, listen, I don't even want to do television anymore, I'm gonna be a surgeon now, okay, I am 100,000% I can do it. I know it. I would figure it out. I wouldn't even have to figure it out. It's just like the universe just tell me. That's how the law of attraction works. But I don't want to be a surgeon. Yeah. So,
well, no. I tell you what, David.
Do what you love, and it'll take care of you.
But you know what? That is something that now I don't know. I still don't know, David. Who is older, you or I? I've got an idea. But anyway,
I believe I'm older because I know I act older than you.
Very funny. I mean, come on, folks.
I know I'm more mature.
Come on, no, folks. Come on, David. Oh, that's almost mean and almost a little hateful. but I'm 29, but I started in media years ago, David, and
yeah, 79, is that right?
Yep. And but you know
and
what?
I think it went to Color TV in what, 82?
No, Color TV was before that. I'm like, come on, David.
I'm just kidding.
Hey, but when I started in media, I mean, it was all black and white TVs, and you had to kick them on the side to make them turn on, right? One of the Archie Bunker TVs. But no, back in the day, I would take radios apart, put them back together to figure out how they worked. I mean, I was a geek before geeks were geeks.
That's fascinating. You said you did some DJing?
Yeah, too? I did. I certainly did. And... you know, I thought, you know, that's kind of cool. Okay, that's lovely. I sort of fell into. But when I first started in news talk radio, I absolutely hated it. I could not stand it. Because, I mean, my brain was not geared toward that. It was geared toward music and putting on stuff for folks to listen to, throwing a commercial every now and then. That's about the size of it. But when I started a news talk, I hated it because I had to be so quick on my feet and be thinking like 10 minutes ahead of time for it to work.
I love radio.
I hated it. News talk, I hated it.
I like radio, and I like using like a radio voice like this and pronouncing really clear.
You know, oh, Lord. You know, David, there
and
is...
I'm stumbling on my words.
Oh, but I know. Sort of like this is... No offense to NPR, but sort of like this is NPR.
I love NPR. I listen to them. Just they could just be reading babble, and I would be like, "So good."
But I mean,
just
NPR.
Like Leo Laporte. Leo Laporte can literally be reading how to do a colonoscopy, and I would be like, "Just listen."
Well, you
There's
know
something about some people,
right?
That, you know.
Well, he has that broadcast voice, and, you know, it's rare, it's very rare that I have found people that have that kind of a quality of a voice naturally.
Right.
Too many people...
But there are tricks you can use if you don't.
Well, yeah, but, I mean, a lot of times people talk from the back of their throat, and they have to make it sound like, you know, they're on the Beverly Hillbillies, you know, but that's not natural.
Here's a trick that they do.
Okay.
You know, See, I just said, you know, like, I'm fighting with it all the time myself. But here's what they do, and this is why it sounds better than, you know, what a normal person may do. They do not use filler words. So they don't say things like, you know, okay, well, like they just don't do that right there. Well, like, yeah, they cut all of that out. They're very clear on the words that they're saying.
That's right.
And they shut up when somebody else is talking, because you sound better if when you're not talking that you're completely silent, seriously. And then when you do talk, that all of your words are not filler words. Like, see, I just said a lot. Like, see,
true enough. How many times have you watched a video or listened to the radio? You listen to somebody, and every third word is "and," "but."
Oh, it's easy. Watch my show. No.
I tell you what. I mean,
it's a struggle. It's a fight.
David, several years ago, we interviewed on our TV show. We had the TV cameras, these HD cameras out there, the big boys that were out there, the whole crew. And we interviewed, oh my heavens, what in the world was his name? The Galloping Gourmet, Graham Kerr. You might remember him from PBS back in the 1970s. Well, we interviewed him at his house, and he was absolutely incredible. But he looked at me, and he goes, "Rub it." He said, "Rub it." He said, "It's never but, it's whatever." So you never say but, you say whatever.
He said that you do not say that?
Yeah, he said no. Yeah. He goes, "Don't ever say but when you're on the air." He said, "Just say whatever." But he called me "rub it." He has this English accent, and it comes out like "rub it."
Also, they say, if you ever do video, never to scratch your nose.
I know.
They taught me that in college.
Okay, I know. But, you know, but sometimes you have an itch, right?
I avoid it.
You know, touching your face, like, oh my God, you know, I don't know what's going on. You know, that is like, come on. Are people going to be watching you pick your nose? Scratch your face or pop your zit.
If you talk about it, like, you'll start getting itchy. The things I do during commercial break are embarrassing.
Well, I try my very best to remain dignified, even through commercial breaks, David.
Like, sometimes I'll be doing TV and I'll have, like, a really nice shirt on and all this stuff. But then below me, I'll have, like, some ratty pair of, pajamas on or something.
Well, you know, above the waist, people can see it, but below the waist, people can't, not when you're on television. Because typically you're sitting down, right?
Right. Although today I did put some cologne on, because cologne makes me feel better. Like, just, so I did, like, spruce myself up, if I am that. But, like, I did clean myself up a little bit, just so. Because sometimes if you do clean yourself up, you just feel, you know.
So, David, speaking of cleaning ourselves up a little bit, later tonight, you are going to be hosting the Dirty Talk Show. Now, what nights is that on live? And what kind of content are people seeing these days on that show?
Well, Dirty Talk is normally on Fridays, right after the Robert Christian Show.
Ah, snap.
Television proudly carries the Robert Christian Show. And then we're going to start carrying his live broadcast too. We got some shit coming up. Okay, but anyways, Dirty Talk is normally right. You know, like, what time is it now? Like, it's normally like around 7 or 8. But it's going to be tomorrow instead, because my co-host Brandon Corey, unless you know, I can get Robert Christian to do a show with me, but Brandon Corey will be on tomorrow.
I must say about Brandon, I had him on a live show. It's probably been two or 3 years ago.
Hmm? How did I not know that?
I have no idea. I thought you did know. Funny thing is, we did the show, and it was specifically about cooking and dieting. And I wanted to ask him the question, speaking of, because you know he is a chef. And just like I asked Graham Kerr, the Galloping Gourmet, I said, look, you know, what kinds of foods are better for people that have compromised immune systems, what they can eat versus what they shouldn't eat to help their, to boost their immune systems, and their health. It was very good, David. I've got that on. I can send you the link to that. I'll have to find it.
Wow. You know, you had meant, like you were saying that you spun some records. I was going to, because I wrote it down to remember. And you were wondering if I've ever DJed or anything?
Yeah, did you ever do that?
Well, you know, I've done a little bit of it. But I just happen to have, there's a few awards I've won for DJing.
You actually got an award for it, David. Where's mine? No.
Well, I just thought, well, you know, I am a club DJ. Like, I am actually a club DJ, and I also DJ for Spotify currently right now. And I do very professional DJing. Like, I'm a super master mixer and all this stuff. However, I keep that part of my life a secret, believe it or not, because I go under a kind of a secret name. Because I do so much stuff that I have to lie to people and not tell them what I do because they won't believe me. Right, but my ass got caught though, and I won awards for it. But I got asked to this award show to present an award, and then they called me for one of them, and then I won like DJ of the Year for the Reader's Choice Awards 2017 DJ of the Year, I have been doing this show, another show on this other place called Two, secretly, and I DJ in my underwear, right, and I make it like real sexy and stuff. But I've been doing that show secretly, and that's what I won the award for, because it gets a lot of viewers, but I didn't know the gay people were watching it. But apparently they are. So, yeah, I do a little DJing.
You know, yes. The
a lot of it, actually.
What other award do you have, David?
Oh, this one's for Gay Life TV's. I won the favorite LGBT social media. From this is a magazine, and then these were readers, like the readers voted.
Awesome.
The thing is, like, I've only seen the magazine twice. Like, I did not even know I was nominated this year, because sometimes I get nominated, but I didn't know. And then this one I won for this one, one of my stars won, actually. This is for Gay Male of the Year. So my stars also win awards. And then also another one, he won Mr. Gay Life. They have a thing called, they have an award called Mr. Gay Life. And he won that too.
Now, David, wouldn't it be kind of cool to have a yearly award ceremony, maybe sponsored by Gay Life Television, and bring people in, bring talent in from all across the United States, to help to participate in it, and who knows, maybe do your own award show.
Well, I'm thinking of it. I wish you lived near me. You and I would be able to, like, I would have like absorbed you, just like I did when I first started Gay Life Television officially. There was another place that was trying to do the same thing called Straight Not Straight TV.
Right, okay. I remember something about that.
So I, when you do that, when you overtake a company? I like to say I've absorbed them, but...
Buy them out.
It wasn't really a buy them out. It was more of a choice thing. Because at that time we were, at that time we would like, his shows, he would like make fun of me. I didn't watch him though, but I finally watched him when he told me that he was doing that. And they even had this puppet that was me that they would like, you know, make it look like I was talking, like whatever. And the reason why they were doing that, because some of my other shows would, you know, like they would have friendly competition back and forth. I thought, like Drag Talk would like cut on one of his shows, be like, yeah, you know. So I just told him, I go, well, we could do one or two things. We can compete. And I was like, I'm a crazy bitch. Do you want to compete with me? Or we could or you can come work for me. I go, or you can come, because I have all the facilities, you know what I'm saying?
Right, right.
And he was going out of his house, and I wasn't trying to hurt him or nothing, but I didn't want to compete with him too. You know, just for the fact, because I didn't feel like it, and I'd rather have his talents with mine. So then, agreed to for him to come and be with me. But I made him stop all of his. But the agreement was he had to, you know, discontinue all of his own station. You know, make it go away. And he did. He was very cooperative, and it was a pleasure to work with him. I don't work with him near as much as I do now, or did before. His name is Joe Krynock, but he's a good man. He's very good for Gaylight Television.
You know, I'll tell you what I think would really be a kick in the pants, and I've talked to Steve about it, and I said, you know, look, and David, this is really, to me, would be absolutely a cool idea, especially in the Northwest, because everybody likes their coffee, they like their tea, their hot drinks. No matter what time of the year it is, Seattle's known for its coffee, among the Space Needle, right? But I think that it would be awesome to set up a coffee house, a tea thing, restaurant that served nothing more than tea or coffee. But in the center of it, there is a glassed off, you know, boarded off room that's sort of in the center, but it's up on a pedestal, sort of. So, and that's where you would do live broadcasting. So you do live talk shows right from there. The background would be the people sitting at the tables enjoying their tea or their coffee or whatever, their conversations. Meanwhile, what you're saying and what you're doing in your booth in this soundproof room, would be broadcast, or not broadcast, but it would be heard at every other table in the house. That would be awesome. It, at least for, like, you know, hey, you come have coffee with us. Come have your get your tea on. That would be awesome, David.
Well, they see, I use those filler words. Pittsburgh at one time had a place called the Waffle House. That, not the Waffle House you're thinking of, but it was actually called the Waffle House. And it was the same exact thing that you said. You almost described it verbatim.
Really? Wow.
Yeah, they only had coffee and tea and waffles. And they had a raised platform in the middle. And then it was not gay, though. It was there for a while. Every time I would go by there, they were closed for, like, but you could tell they were open, you know, at least. So I think they were opened up in the morning. And then they're not there anymore. So I don't know what happened. I think that's a great concept. But for that to work, which it would, you have to have location.
You bet.
That location here where they had that was not in a good location. Like, the people that would go to that weren't there. Like, they were on the other part of town. Or else they would have went. You know, so that something like that is all about location when you're getting live audience stuff. What did they do?
Well, David, I want to switch gears for a second, because people have asked me before how in the world that I ever run into you, or I don't know how exactly. Anyway, the storyline behind that. Is this, folks. Back in the day, during the height of the Occupy Wall Street movement, David, I'm sure you remember that group. They would be protesting this and that and the other thing, and it was constantly on the go back in the day. But one of the room moderators in one of the other chat rooms online that I would frequent, I was talking to him, and he said, look, you're doing talk shows. Check this group out. And he sent me the link to Gaylight Television. And he said, check these guys out. And so I went to your website. I checked it out. I enjoyed to the highest of the high everything about the website. I was like, hey, this is awesome. Where did you find this? He doesn't even live in your area, but he knew about it. Now it's like, wait a second, you know, what's up with this? How did you know about this? And so, David, To his credit, I give him credit for that because he got me with you in that way, and I'm forever grateful that he did.
Me too. What's his name?
Oh my gosh! I knew you were going to ask me that question. You know what? I don't know off the top of my head.
It's John McCarthy.
Oh Lord! Well, it wasn't. His name wasn't John. Goodness gracious! He lived in just south of Chicago. Wow. There's that filler word again. That and so anyway, I don't know. I'd have to look and. Anyway, that's where he lived, and he still does. And so he did a sort of a brief search for him, and he said, well, contact these guys. And I said, oh, okay. Well, I looked at you, and I remember contacting you. And I said, you know what? I love your content. I want to air some of your content. I did.
I always say if you're a content producer, you gay people out there listening or whoever, you know, and you make some YouTube videos and – even if they're not getting a lot of views or something, that doesn't matter. Don't stop because you never know who's watching. The right person could be watching.
Like, that's right.
I work with Clear Channel Media now. And the guy who runs that called me on my phone. Like, you know, because he got our channel on Roku. So, you know, there you go. So you never know who's watching. Never give up is what I'm saying.
No,
you get folks.
I tell you though, you know, for me as a content provider, David as a broadcaster, sort of hand in hand, sort of kind of. But for me as a content provider, it becomes very difficult to find adequate but positive syndication. And when you're doing shows the way that I do, I mean, syndication is absolutely the key to success.
Right. The problem that 92% of content providers, particularly if they're LGBT, I don't know why, but they do not, you know, they give up. I see so many shows, go on YouTube, whatever. You see somebody who's got a nice, ambitious idea to start a show, maybe about drag queens or whatever, and they start off good and they get into about, you'll see them, the most they ever make is about 8. You know, shows if they're lucky, but they usually get up to about 3 or 4, and then they just kind of phase out, because, as you know, in the game of television and things like that, or online media, the thing about online media that's a little bit different about maybe than television is endurance. Bitch, you gotta be around. You gotta be around. You gotta be around when the times are high. You gotta be around when the times are low.
That's right, David. You're right.
That's how you get your name out there, and what you do.
Trust me, you're right. But when it comes to syndication, just because you might have your name out there, doesn't necessarily mean that you're going to be picked up by a big network. As a matter of fact, David, I was asked just a few weeks ago if I would ever consider going and doing anything on the Sirius XM radio network, the satellite radio. And I said, you know what, I would definitely do it. But in the conversation went on and said, well, you might end up having to move to L.A. because that's where they're based out of. And I'm like,
where's the plane ticket, honey? That's what I'd be like, listen, I'll pay for my own plane ticket. I don't give a fuck. What do you want me to
air? I would most definitely do Sirius XM. No question about it. But, you know, I think that when it comes to syndication, it is a very difficult marketplace. And to begin with, it is. But when you are in one group, like you are LGBT, you're an LGBT news talk show host, then that really narrows down your chances of being syndicated in a big time way, you know, in many different markets around the country because of that alone. So if you focus on more of a broader idea for your show and for your content, maybe it'll help to open doors up. But David, it's hard. It's difficult.
Well, saying that, even like, you know, I am thinking about making a show that appeals to everyone. I'm also not a person that's about, you would think I would be because, you know, I have Gay Life Television and stuff like that. And you would think that I'm a person that believes and lives and breathes inclusion.
Yeah.
And I do to a certain degree, but I don't to a certain degree too. I forget what I was telling you that, but well, there actually is a point where I'm telling you that.
But inclusion versus exclusion.
Right. Well, I think you can go ahead and do you know what that is? Like, obviously. Well, here's why. I had it's kind of an example of what we're talking about. There's this person who made this video about, and it's on YouTube, like about the word masculine.
Okay.
There, actually, it's a city paper here in Pittsburgh about the use of the word masculine. So he went to the gay bars and then, you know, but he's trying to make it like, you know, that using the word masculine is a bad thing. Okay, I personally don't believe it is. And, you know, my response was to that was like, you know, why are we as gay people trying to like make the word masculine a bad word and be like, we're trying to, and the reason why is because it seems like you're being exclusive instead of inclusive. And I get it with the inclusion thing. I think that, you know, for opening up our borders in our country and all that kind of stuff and churches and whatever and places, you know, that should be inclusive. But I think when it comes down to your sexuality, you should be able to be exclusive. What word am I going to use to describe somebody that doesn't, you know, to describe somebody, a non-femme person? What am I going to use? Why aren't they also saying the word femme? Nobody's ever said anything, a damn thing about the word femme. That, to me, that's, you know, why is that not as bad as the word masculine? Why is the word masculine a bad word? But anyway, I don't even care if it's a bad word, or else give me a better word.
I think this way, David, that America is very stuck up and very stubborn, based on old tradition, and the tradition was that gay people, that was a love that did not bear its name. Like, we're living back in the 1800s now. And so, you know, it's okay if you are that way, just don't tell anybody, just do it behind closed doors, and that's it. But now we do have marriage equality. Now we do have equal rights and equal protections within the law.
Right, and equal's okay.
Yeah.
But that's, to me, though, like, what they're trying to do, I think people are trying to do, is intertwine, like they're confusing equalness with inclusion. Does that make sense? Like, do you know what I mean? Like,
yep.
Like, they're thinking, well, now that we have equal rights, you know, whatever, that we can marry, and we did get those rights because out of the will to have inclusion, and that's appropriate in that situation. But what do you think about sexuality? Do you think for sexual? Because I don't think that I have to, like, in my own opinion, I don't think I should be forced to like everybody. Like, I'm not allowed to be exclusive. But I have to like everybody. Tops, bottoms, twisted, sideways, whatever. I got to like you all. Because if I don't, then I'm being exclusive, and that's wrong.
I think that somewhat, personally, I think that somebody's sexuality, it is a private, it is a personal matter. Absolutely.
There's no way it can't be exclusive.
Yes.
However, you're being exclusive privately, then that's exactly what you're going to do.
However, because America has become such a nanny state in its mentality when it comes to sexuality, in a big time way, you compare Europe, England, men, when they greet each other, you know what? They give each other a kiss on the cheek. No big deal.
They walk their whole hands.
They're used to that. That is their the way they do it. That is their culture. But if you did that in America, oh, good grief. So, you know, I think that we can learn a lot from it. But I think that America, it is way behind the times. It claims to at least be more tolerant these days. I don't want tolerance, David. I want acceptance. I want people not to say, well, okay, I'll tolerate you for another day. I mean, good God Almighty. But no, forget it. I want people to say, you know what? I'm going to accept you. No matter who you are, no matter what you are, no matter if you're a rich man or a poor man, black man or a white man, I'm going to receive you and accept you. That's what I think, David.
Would tolerance and acceptance be the same thing?
No.
Because I agree with you. I think you should have acceptance, but
tolerance is second best.
If you're intolerant, would that not force you to be unacceptable? Do you know what I mean? Like, I have low tolerance for somebody.
Tolerance, that is playing second best. That's saying, you know, it's second best. Okay. For an example, do you want a cup of caffeinated coffee or decaf? We're out of caffeinated, so okay, well, I'll tolerate a cup of decaf, right? Versus saying, not really, I would prefer to have caffeinated. You know what I mean? Because you accept the caffeinated coffee. You tolerate the decaf.
Right. So what you're saying is stick with yourself.
Right.
And be accepting, but be like, but it's okay. I'm not going to have, because I like caffeinated, I'm not going to have that decaffeinated. I'm not going to, you know, settle for that.
Correct.
But it's okay that you have decaffeinated over there. That's fine. That's great.
Exactly. That is right. Bingo.
There's no problem with it. I just don't want any of it.
So, I mean, I don't want people, and David, for you even, I don't want people to tolerate you, David. I want people to accept you. I don't want people to tolerate Gay Life Television either for whatever that obnoxious reason is. I want people to accept it. And I mean, for crying out loud, going back to Gay Life TV, David, you can learn an awful lot about not sexuality, but you can learn an awful lot of other things that maybe you don't know about by watching shows that are like on Gay Life Television. And I'm telling you, I'm just putting it out there. You do, because, I mean, David, you're across the board. You're like I am in a lot of ways.
Yes.
We're both losing our hair. We're both just about lost our mind. Let's see, what else?
We're both gorgeous. No.
He has the beard thing. I did that beard thing one time, David, and I was like, oh, no, that just is not going to work, because I got too tired of my face itching, and it was just obnoxious. So, no.
A beard thing?
Yeah. That just was not going to work.
You know, I still get paid for my looks, even though my ass is old.
So now he's going to admit his age, David. Oh, okay, I see how he is.
I am a model for Totem Wolf.
Oh, speaking of that photo, David, I did not get it. Sorry about interrupting you.
Yeah, that's actually one of my modeling photos.
But we're
that's one of the ones I'm keeping.
We are just about out of time for the first hour of the show, and then I got to hurry up and switch gears. You have an upcoming party in Pittsburgh, yes?
Yes, I do. I have another company called Pittsburgh M4M, and it's a private men's club for adult gay men. And we have, one, two, or three parties every month. We have them at, like, mansions, and we're having it, this time it's at a mansion in a place called Natrona Heights. Pool and all stuff, but they're very, very large parties, and that's kind of what it is. I like to say that it's old school gay partying, so it's not like all this stupid ass new shit. Not wrong new stuff, okay? But the way these kids be partying now, you know, they be doing tea and meth and all that shit.
Is there a website where people can go for information?
Yes, there is.
Lovely. Okay, what is it?
The website is PittsburghM4M.com. I have a graphic I sent you. I don't know if you are able to show it, but
I'll get it up in post editing.
So there you go. But that's the graphic. The party is the 17th of November. If any of you in Pittsburgh are watching, I'm sure you're already gone, but if you're planning a trip to Pittsburgh, please check out the website, and you can become a member of Pittsburgh Men for Men, and then you can go to the party. But then also, the reason why we're a private men's club is because I interview every single person that is a member there. We have over 1,900 members in the city alone. And yes, I have talked to all of them. So say you were to become a member today, within a year, no, within like a month or two, I will end up giving you a phone call or contacting you to set up an interview. And then I'll usually do that by phone. So it's not an interview to suck, you know, to do anything to you or you do anything, you know, it's a legit interview. And then I make sure that you're a cool person, that you're not, you know, I don't know how to explain it. Make sure you got good vibe, because I'm a very good judge of character, I think. And but that has made the club very, very popular. You know, it just has, like, it grows all the time, especially when, like, right before I'm having a party and all that stuff. It's just, I have spent all day today just answering, like, I call it customer service for that, just handling customer needs, that, you know, people signing up and questions about the party and all this other stuff.
Well, David, you're a busy man, and I do want to thank you for spending some time on today's live show to fill us in on Gay Love Television and now the parties and what you're doing there. That's awesome.
Yeah, thank you. Well, you know, it's always a pleasure to be – well, I don't know. It's my first time. I'm sure it's always a pleasure to be on the Robert Christian Show. No, it is. It's always fun to –
Well, we have, as you know, numerous guests from all walks of life, celebrity interviews and more. And but at times, the waiting list just to get on the show is 6 months in advance.
Well, you'd be getting good people. Like, I'm surprised with the people you interview.
I mean, I do my best. You know, politicians to, you know, like I say, celebrities. I mean, I think it's amazing at where the show has been and where it's going in its future. And David, you know, I think that you are on the right track with what you're doing as well. And certainly I don't think that you are going to give up anytime soon.
No, it's my mission to also show the happy, you know, Gay Life Television, you know, it means gay people, but in a way it doesn't as well. It actually means happy TV. I mean, its coreness, its roots, is happy television. That just, but you know, I happen to be gay, so now it's Gay Life Television. But you know, that's, and I do think it should help gay people. But I'm all for happiness for everybody. I wish everybody would just be happy. So I try to. That's what I try to create. And I know I have a voice to do that now. So, and I use it.
Well, yeah. It's time, David. You know, it's time for the community at large, and we didn't really get into it, but the community at large to step up the plate and support media outlets, to support businesses that are LGBT owned and operated, managed businesses, and help them. You know, again, we can learn so much from each other. Say again?
Gay people should do that deliberately. Support, like make it like a mission, like a war on gay businesses, that you're gonna kill them with money.
That's it. You know, I mean, people these days, they have spending power, they have money to spend, they have money to help with different causes, and I think it's great. It's you know, when you're able to do something, that's great.
You know how gay laws are created, right?
How's that?
Oh, like how they, like the, how gay marriage came about and all this stuff. Here's how they form gay laws. They have people in the government that go and search how many gay people, when it comes to like laws, whatever law it is, too, it's not just gay laws, but gay laws. They will search cities and everything and find out what cities have the most gay businesses in it. Gay businesses and gay activity. Not how many damn gay people live there. Because they need the bazillion gay people can live in one town, but if you ain't doing shit, then it don't mean anything. So the government goes and looks for gay businesses and gay activity. Okay,
right.
Got that, people? Gay businesses, gay activity. That's how they decide the law. So they go to that city and figure out what those gay people want, and that's how they decide the law. That's a fact. Yep. Call them up if you can get through. That is how law works. That's how that law works. That's true. So, that's what I'm trying to tell you. You have to deliberately go and support your gay businesses. A town of 500 gay people that support all their businesses is going to win out over a town of 5,000 gay people, which is always, you know, that aren't doing shit. Okay?
Yep.
So, I'm just saying. So, you all get that, right? It's important to watch the Robert Christian Show, to watch my show, to watch Brittany Maxwell. to watch RuPaul's damn drag race. Okay?
That's exactly it. And he's just saying. All right, David. Hey, it's been a joy having you on, but I do need to switch gears in a heartbeat hurry. But hey, I will be in touch with you probably by the end of tonight, and let you know where the video is and where the podcast is, so you can do with what you will. With
that, it'll air on Gay Life Television.
Snap! Yeah, it'll be on Gay Life Television at a later date. Well, right now it's probably okay. Well. Everybody and gets the picture.
Show is also on demand on Gay Life Television. But listen, if you're going to watch if you're watching now and you're going to go watch Robert Christian anything, go to Robert Christian's thing to watch it first, and then go to Gay Life Television.
Okay? Well, both. I mean, yeah, the rerun's always better, right? You always miss something, right?
All yeah, right, but David, you can watch all the reruns in your thing.
Well, it's been a joy, David, having you on.
Thank you. It's been a joy being on.
All right, David, we will catch you real soon. Hang on, if you will, Mr. David. All right, ladies and gentlemen, this is the Robert Christian Show, where your voice, your opinion, they do matter. So stick around. We'll be right back.